I take big exception to the very first point you made. You said that when it comes to domestic violence in this country, you cannot have an overcorrection. I'm sorry, you can if the accused is innocent as charged. That's an overcorrection.
We don't know that,
so,
Skip.
So we want to brand him as a domestic abuser if, in fact, he didn't do anything, because you just need to overcorrect it because it's domestic violence and you got to take a stand against domestic violence. Who doesn't think that?
Hold on, Skip. You talk about overcorrection. Ray Rice was the overcorrection. He lost his career. Okay. Zeke is only going to lose 6 games. That's the overcorrection. Mm. He missed the point.
Okay, but that was because the commissioner, this commissioner, is never ahead of the curve. He's never heading off the crisis at the past. He's never seeing it before it happens.
How could he foresee domestic violence?
He's always reacting. He's reacting. Well, they should have been way ahead. This has been going on for years and years. Do you know how many cases have slipped under the carpet?
Baseball, NBA, nobody had a domestic violence thing, policy in place until Ray Rice incident. So why didn't they head it off at the curve? Why hadn't America head it off at the curve? Oh, okay.
Okay, well, no, the problem here is that clearly, I've been saying this for months, Jerry Jones said exactly what I've been saying, that clearly, after the Ray Rice fiasco, and it was a fiasco for this league. You disagree with that?
Oh, no, no question about it.
Thank you very much.
And then you had Greg Hardy and your guy Adrian Peterson on top of that.
So clearly, Roger Goodell is not now trying to save face by making example of a breakout star in Ezekiel Elliott without credible or conclusive proof or evidence. Period. End of story. So he's overcorrecting what he didn't do with Ray Rice, Greg Hardy, as you say, and then with Josh Brown. And in this case, it smacks of Deflategate, except in Deflategate, he was just trying to destroy the reputation, sacrifice the reputation of the greatest quarterback ever, but he was just accused of cheating and lying about it, of deflating a football. This is domestic violence. So we've gone to the most serious issue here.
Absolutely.
And again, this is where you have to be even more careful. And as you point out, not one but two police departments interviewed the accuser and found her not credible. Then Kia Roberts, and remember her background, 8 years, the assistant DA in Brooklyn, after she graduated from Duke undergrad and Vanderbilt Law School, she chose not to join a high-powered law firm. She had such backbone, she said she wanted to go fight for justice at the lowest, toughest level in Brooklyn as an assistant DA, and she handled domestic violence case after domestic violence case, and she was the only member of the NFL office, as she had just recently been hired as the director of investigations by Roger Goodell and Lisa Friel. She was the only member of that front office to interview the accuser 6 times and found her not credible. But Kia Roberts was cut out of the final meeting in which the punishment was decided upon by Roger Goodell, Lisa Friel, and others, except for Kia Roberts. So she went out on her own and contacted the NFL Players Association and said, will you let me testify at the appeals hearing? Well, sure we will. So she basically blew the whistle on her two bosses in the appeals process, and still that didn't matter. The Harold Henderson says the suspension stands.
Because he was not compelled. The CBA is not compelled
now
to have
get
you cross-examined.
CBA. Yep. Thank you for bringing that up.
Sure.
So now the plot thickens, or I should say sickens, because you want to talk about outrageous, you want to talk about unfair. Now we find out that the husband of Judge Fela, who threw this case out of her court in Manhattan the other day,
here.
The husband of Judge Fela works for the law firm that negotiated the CBA for the National Football League against the Players Association back in, when was it,
2011.
And they forged, that law firm forged the document with which she referred to throw Zeke's case out of court. Now, this is the same Judge Fela who back in 2012, when she took her judgeship, signed a judicial questionnaire that says, my husband is a partner for the law firm of Proskauer Rose. I would recuse myself from any cases in which Proskauer Rose is a party or representing a party. Does this not qualify as that? Is this not a classic conflict of interest? Is this not at least a hint of impropriety? Are you kidding me? So she was on vacation. She had a couple of weeks to sit back and think, you know what? This is, if nothing else, is just a bad look because my husband works for that law firm that represents the National Football League. This just looks bad. I think I recuse myself because remember, in her Southern District, there are 42 other possible judges you could have used to handle this case. And what happened, Shannon Sharpe? She handled it, and she just rubber-stamped the NFL's opinion and said, get out of my courtroom. After the Texas judge had argued, in his opinion, that this was eminently unfair, she said this was completely fair. Get out of my courtroom. Really?
So I just want to make sure.
You love this, Shannon? You've crusaded for judicial reform in this country, especially when it comes to how it's served upon black people in this country. And here is, I'll give you a wealthy young black man, but he gets thrown out of court on an obvious conflict of interest. Aren't you outraged by this? I would think you would be. But no, you seem to be defending the National Football League and the collective bargaining agreement.
Here's the thing, Skip.
My God.
I just want to ask you this. Why haven't we heard Jerry Jones speak out in other cases in which Roger Goodell has decided?
Okay. Keep it here. Do you like this? You didn't answer.
Okay.
Do you like it? Do you like her conflict of interest? Should she have recused herself?
I'm going to get there,
Skip. Well, don't change the subject.
I'm not going to change the subject, Skip. If there was a problem, what the standard that the NFL uses, they adopted this policy in 2008. 32 owners said anybody that falls up under the umbrella, preponderance of the evidence, more probable than not. So basically 51%, if Commissioner Goodell, because remember, he's the judge, the jury, and the executioner, and the appellate officer. Mm-hmm. If he believes by more probable than not that it occurred, mm-hmm. he gets to ride with it. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad you brought that up because her husband worked at the law firm. But it was brought to my attention in that same article that you failed to mention that Richard Berman, who ruled in favor of Tom Brady 2 years ago, it came to light that Judge Berman was present at a party attended by Robert Kraft. And, I mean, hey, who knows? Anything could have happened. It also came to people's attention that Judge Berman... A guy worked in the same law firm. Hold on, let me finish.
No, but they just wound up at the same party. Okay. Robert Kraft inviting him to the party. Happened to be at the same party.
Can I finish?
Is that like your husband working for the law firm that defends the NFL?
It also was brought to light that Robert Kraft and a person who worked in the same law firm as Judge Berman from 1970 to 1974.
This is absurd.
Hold on, Skip. But are you going to let me talk? Stop talking over me. I didn't talk over you.
Okay, but in the article, they were pointing out how far-fetched that was. That was Mike Florio's article on, what is it called, Pro Football Talk? And he was talking about how petty that was.
The same article that you got that interview from.
Okay, but he's saying, this isn't petty. That was petty.
Oh, it's petty.
That's how he characterized it. Well, that's how he wrote it.
Tell
the people what he wrote.
That's
what he wrote.
That's the summation. But I'm just saying, Skip, she is her husband representing Zeke, the NFL, in this case now.
No, but he's a partner in the law firm, and she signed the declaration. If there's any hint of impropriety, I'm out.
Can I ask you a question?
Should she have recused herself, Shannon Sharpe?
No, she didn't have to.
Oh, please.
No, she doesn't have to.
You should be outraged over this.
I'm outraged that you're out. Okay, how about this here? Let me read something else. See, you won't let me finish my statement. This is what Jerry Jones said about Roger Goodell in 2015 on Debategate. Obviously, he has a very tough job. Now I see people doing that. It's the old violin, people feeling sorry for themselves. But this is why we pay him the big bucks to deal with big problems. Later in the same interview, Joy Taylor, he say, you know you have to make some tough decisions that's going to be very unpopular to a particular group. Owners, that's what's happening in this case. That's what he said about Mr. Bob Kraft in 2015 about Deflategate. He had no sympathy. He had no problem with Roger Goodell ruling. Now, guess what? Mr. Goodell came knocking on his door. Now, all of a sudden, he has too much power. All of a sudden, now, he's grasping at straws. You should have brought this to the attention in 2008 when preponderance of the evidence was ruled that would be the law of the land. I get it, Jerry. You're right. If this was in a normal society, but the NFL is different. The CBA is the law of the land that you ratified with other 31 owners, 32-0 unanimously. So don't come crying poor me now.
Unless you're crying about something that deserves to be cried about. Do you believe that Zeke is guilty of domestic violence?
It doesn't matter what I believe. It only matters what you can prove. Commissioner Goodell believes it, Skip. That's how it works.
Do you like that?
I believe George Zimmerman murdered Trayvon Martin, but it doesn't matter what I believe. They couldn't get a conviction. It matters what you can prove. Roger Goodell believes it. That's all that matters. And you getting all these, Skip, you're in your feelings. I get it. It's the Cowboys.
This is outrageous, and you know
it. I get it, Skip.
You know what? Your emotions are so mixed about this.
I ain't got no mixed emotions. Mm. I'm just telling you what the CBA says, and that's what I'm going by. You want to throw out the CBA now? It's been binding since 2011. There have been so many guys that's come before Commissioner Goodell and said the process was unfair, but nobody had a problem with it. He's always had these powers.
Tom Brady had a huge problem with it and took it all the way to the Court of Appeals, where this case now rests because they did yesterday get this filed in time in the Court of Appeals.
How did it end up for Tom Brady?
He backed out at the last second. I know for a fact because I was close to people on the team. They were poised to go to the Supreme Court with it, but the season was approaching, and he said, I can't do this to my football team.
This is what we know for a fact. Mm-hmm. All that other stuff is conjecture, speculation, and innuendo.
But I will tell you this.
He missed four games.
You know what? Tom Brady went a long way toward clearing his reputation because he won at the level of this woman's court. It wasn't her. It was Judge Berman who did it. But he laughed the NFL out of court, which sent the NFL to the appeals process in the Second Circuit.
Okay, can you ask me this? If I were to do something and I get convicted at a lower state court and I go to the appeals court and they overturn it, can you tell the people what would happen to me? I get to go free. They at the lower level, they overturned it. He went to the appeals court, they reinstated it. So what happened?
You could take it if you could get the Supreme Court to hear it.
I don't know if you could do, but I'm telling you, would you tell the people what happened? What did Tom Brady end up doing?
They were poised to go to the Supreme Court, and the season was upon them. And Tom Brady said, for the sake of my football team, because I've become too big a distraction, I'm going to eat the four games, and then I'm going to make Roger Goodell eat that trophy. And
Skip.
Did he do it?
Skip.
Did he do
Skip.
It? Was he not on a mission?
There is not a distraction big enough that I would not go through to clear my name. Mm. That's me.
Okay.
Because at the end of the day, that's what I'm riding on.
That's what Ezekiel Elliott is doing as we speak.
Skip, I'm not saying I disagree with what he's doing. I don't have a problem with him fighting. I think you're trying to imply that I have a problem with him fighting it. I don't. I'm trying to explain to you.
I know exactly what it is. But see, at some point, the court system in this country supersedes that collective bargaining. It does. In the end, Jerry Jones is saying, any citizen of this country deserves to get a fair appeals process, even under whatever the collective bargaining
says.
Well,
then why did Jerry agree to it?
And that's why the first judge in Texas looked at it and said, this is laughable. He did not get a fair shake.
And the judge said, had he not gone through this process, if Commissioner Goodell would have just suspended Zeke without hearing any testimony, without having a process, now we're on to something. Now I'm worried about this. She said, but he followed the rules. You went through the process. He's under no obligation to let you cross-examine the alleged victim. Mm-hmm. He's under no obligation to let you cross-examine him or the appeals officer. Skip, you're right. Asking for something that's not in the CBA.
So here's the final elephant in the room. Roger Goodell got one huge break in this case, and it happened on St. Patrick's Day when video was captured of Ezekiel Elliott pulling that woman's top down during the celebration up on the rooftop.
You blame Roger Goodell or Zeke?
No, I'm just saying that, it's all about perception is reality.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show, and be sure to check out more of the best clips from Undisputed or go watch a few segments from our other shows on FS1.